My name is Thomas Rasmussen and I'm from the company Ipsen Photonics, and in this tutorial I'll talk about fluorescence spectroscopy. So there are many different types of spectroscopy methods that you can use, and it can be really difficult to know which one to choose for a given application. But when you're dealing with biological material, there's a good chance that fluorescence spectroscopy is a good choice for you. So that could be, for instance, for analyzing plants or human or animal tissue or maybe DNA. And another area is that if you have really low concentrations of your material, then fluorescence is typically three orders of magnitude better than your UV absorbance spectroscopy. So in this tutorial, first I'll talk a little bit about the basics of fluorescence spectroscopy. And then I'll talk about some of the fluorescent materials that's commonly used. They're called fluorophores. And instruments for fluorescent spectroscopy comes in many different names and also shapes and sizes. So I will go through some of the more common ones and explain those in this presentation. And then finally, I'll go through some typical applications. Of course, concentration measurements is one, but also doing time-resolved fluorescence spectroscopy and also fluorescence resonance energy transfer, also known as FRET, I will briefly cover. Let's get started with the basics of fluorescence spectroscopy. So this small animation basically shows how fluorescence works. So you send in light at one wavelength, illustrated by the green arrows here, to the fluorophore, and the fluorophore will emit light at another wavelength, illustrated by the red arrows here. So a material that has this property is called a fluorophore normally, but you can also find them named as dyes or labels or stains. Here we are looking at the excitation and emission spectra, so the optical spectra of a fluorophore. And the key thing here is that a fluorophore always absorbs light at the low wavelengths, as short wavelengths, illustrated by the green graph here, and it's emitting light at longer wavelengths, illustrated by the red graph here. Now, in order to understand a little bit more about how the molecule is exchanging energy with the light, we can look at the electromagnetic waves and how they carry energy. So from your physics class, you may remember that light can be explained or understood as electromagnetic waves with a certain wavelength. And the wavelength is the distance between two wave tops, and a speed, which is of course the speed of light, which is the speed that the wave tops are traveling with. But you can also describe light as particles, so a lot of small blinks, you can say, which is called photons. And the nice thing is that each photon carries a small part of energy given by this formula here. So the energy of a photon is given by a constant, which is called Planck's constant, and then by the speed of light c and the wavelength lambda. So the key point in this formula here is that the energy of the photons is inversely proportional to the wavelengths. So what this means is that the longer the wavelength, the less energy the photons carries. So we will use that in the next slides. So now we can go back and analyze how the molecule is exchanging energy with the light. And we do that with an energy diagram like this one here, which is often called a Jablonski diagram. And this shows the allowed energy states that the molecule can be in. So normally the molecule will be in its ground state down here, resting. But when we send in a photon with a certain wavelength, and that means that the photon also carries a certain specific energy, then the fluorophore molecule can absorb that energy. And that means that the energy of the molecule gets raised to a higher level. And from this level, typically the molecule will relax a little bit and be in a kind of an upper steady state. From this upper state, the molecule can go down to the ground state again, and by doing so, it will emit a photon or a small part of energy. So this process can go on and on, repeating, but the key point here is that the energy being absorbed, so this arrow here, is a little bit longer than the energy being emitted, illustrated by the red arrow here. So that means we always absorb a little bit more energy and emit less energy. When we convert that to wavelengths, it's the reverse. So we always absorb light at shorter wavelengths and emit light at longer wavelengths. So this is the explanation for that. A final thing to talk about in fluorescence spectroscopy is the timing. Because the process of fluorescence is generally very, very fast, meaning that the time from the photon is absorbed until a new one is emitted is typically very short, in the order of nanoseconds or something like that. And this is actually being used in what's called time-resolved spectroscopy, where you use laser pulses that are very narrow, so very short laser pulses, and then you use a fast gated camera or PMT detector where you can actually follow the very short decay of the fluorescence. And in this way you can find out a lot of things about not only the fluorophore but also the surrounding area of the molecule. There's another way of time-resolved spectroscopy where you use special fluorophores that have much longer decay times, so in the order of microseconds or milliseconds, and you can use that to make sure that you're actually only measuring the time when you have fluorescence and you're blocking out other light sources like the pulse laser, for instance, or maybe some background light. And in general, that's simply a way to improve your signal-to-noise ratio of your measurements.